So it's so nice that so many of us has got up early this morning on a weekend to come here just to find out how we can get an edge into our lives, right? I think this is what the entire world really seeks after, that we should be a little better so that we can really make a mark in this world. So today the topic given to me is Bible-based decision-making skills that give you an edge. Okay, so when they invited me to come over here, I just prayed about it and said yes. And then they gave me the topics and again I prayed about it. But I was asking God an important question. I was saying, Lord, am I the right person to be over here speaking to this esteemed group of people? Am I the right person? Is it some mistake that I've been invited? I was having my doubts, right? So the Lord in his own way answered, you know, I used a donkey to speak to Balaam. So don't you think that I can use you? So here I am today, just the Lord's mouthpiece, bringing his message to you. So hope the Lord will speak to you through these slides, which I'm going to present over here. So Bible-based decision-making skills. So let's talk about decisions first. Okay? Decisions. Right from the time we wake up to the time we go to bed. Every day, we are making decisions. Okay? Maybe the first difficult decision being the one, when am I supposed to get out of this bed? Right? Many of them have that kind of a difficult decision. Okay? Let's snooze for 5 more minutes. Okay, then we have some very easy, paltry decisions, okay? Sometimes even that is difficult. What to wear, what to cook, what to eat, right? And then we have this difficult decisions which really we give so much thought into. Sometimes we make hasty decisions, right? And we regret it. Sometimes we really give thought, ask all opinions and then take the decision. And even then, sometimes we get to regret it. So is there some way to make the right decision? Is there some strategy? Right? Just like Karuna and many others over here, today the best place to go and look this up is Google. And so if you Google and say, okay, strategies for making good decisions, you'll be surprised that so many people are giving different kinds of strategies. There are 20 point, 15 point, 8 point, and whatnot. I've put up 5-point strategy, which kind of summed up all the other strategies. It is a summary of all of them. So this is what basically it said, okay? The first step, it said, was identify a goal. You are going to make a decision. So what is the result that you expect? What is your goal? So that is the first thing you're supposed to do. So take some time and really understand what are you going to decide about, what do you expect as a goal, right? Simple enough. The next step they said was, now find out all the options that you have, right? So that might require some gathering some information, doing some research, find out all the options that you have, right? Now you have all the options, step two over. Now weigh each of these options, right? Weigh each of these options, okay, the pros, the cons, how feasible it is for me to take up this option, weigh it, okay? Then, the next thing is you make your decision. You make your decision, you've now weighed the pros and cons, you choose the one which is most suited to you, right? And after you made the decision, right, the last step, evaluate. Right? You evaluate and see whether you made the right decision, how far you've succeeded, are you glad about the decision or are you sorry about the decision, and then you store up this information for next time. This is what basically all these strategies are telling us. Okay? So next time you have to go there and make a decision. If you remember all these points, try and use them. Do you think that you're going to get the right decision by using all these points? Like 100, now I don't have this Mentimeter which she was using, it's very good. Now you can get the answers immediately. Because people hardly like to talk, you know. Nowadays we all like to use the our phones to give answers too. So anyway, supposing we use this, do we think that we'll get 100% yes, correct answer, correct decision by using this strategy? No, right? Because it says again in the last step, evaluate and see whether you are glad or sorry about it. Okay, it's only a way, it's a guide. Okay, think about it, don't make hasty decisions. I think that's what all these strategies are telling us, right? So, can the Bible help us to make a better decision? Okay, so the strategies aren't foolproof. So now we go a step further and ask whether the Bible can give us some help in making better decisions, right? Can basing our decisions on the Bible give us an edge, right? A little about me. I am, as you said, an income tax officer, assistant commissioner of income tax, right? Okay, so, but the Lord chose me when I was a kid, and He has been leading me, and this teaching which He has been giving me has been there throughout my life. And though actually I am an income tax assistant commissioner, I am, wherever I am, the first thing is I am His child, and wherever He has placed me, I am His child. And so I'm not telling this just about from my experience as income tax assistant commissioner, but from experience of life and from whatever the Lord has told me. So here, can basing our decisions on the Bible give us an edge? Okay, so anyway, we feel that this must be sure. Bible is the good book. So surely if we base it on the Bible, it should give us better decisions. Let's look at it more deeply now. Many times, you know, some decisions are so difficult that we think that why do we have to take this decision? It'll be nice if somebody else took the decision for us, right? So the next question is, was man meant to make decisions? Okay, was he meant to make decisions? Well, yes, because God gave man a free will. We were not programmed, we are not made like robots, so that God can just control us and just say, yes, now go there, do this, get up. No, He's given us a free will. So yeah, that's how we have ended up making so many, many decisions every day, right? Okay, the next question is there just one right decision? Is there just one right decision, or can there be many other decisions? Okay, so let's see what the Bible tells about this. The Bible tells that God has a plan. We have it right there in the most familiar verse, Jeremiah 29:11 says, "For I know the plans I have for you," right? Plans to prosper you and not to harm you, to give you a hope and a future. Now, we believe the Bible. We believe it's true, right? So God has a plan. Just when we humans, we create something, we do something, we plan so much for it. The planning for this event, I believe, started way back in December 2018, right? When we itself plan so much, how much more the Lord who creates us would plan? You know, the Lord doesn't create us like, you know, churning out us out of machines, right? The Lord takes pains and makes each one of us unique. Each one of us are uniquely made. We're sure of that? No one of us is like another. Each one of us are uniquely made, right? And when He's taking so much pains to make us so unique, don't each of us have a unique plan? Definitely He has created a great, beautiful plan for each one of us, right? So now we know that God has a plan. So if God has a plan for our lives and He already knows about it, the decision which would coincide with this plan of God would naturally be the very best decision, right? The most best decision in my life at each point of my life would be the decision which would coincide with God's plan for me, right? So now, how do I know this decision, this plan? Now, if I don't know this plan, how can I take these decisions? Now, I really feel that, why didn't the Lord actually program me so that I can act, can do things, speak according to His plan? why didn't he do that? Now he's given us this free will. Now it's a bit confusing. No, why is it like God wanted to have a kind of a game that we would guess his plan? Right? Let's go back to the creation story. Right? Creation story, we read that man was made in the image of God. God made man in his image. Now what does that mean? Were we made in his physical image? Was it the physical image of God? You know, the way we look, only God looks. Well, the Bible also tells us that God is spirit. God is spirit. So God has created us in his spiritual likeness. God created man in his spiritual likeness. So in the spiritual part of us, he created us like himself. That means we had the nature of God in us. His character and his mind was given to man as a special extra than the other creations, right? And you know why he would have given that to us? The Lord wanted to have, the Lord always wants and wanted to have a relationship, a close relationship with man, right? He wants to have a close relationship with man. So he gave him the same likeness of his nature and his mind. So we know as friends, as when people with whom we have good relations are people who are like-minded, right? We always say like-minded people can be together, work together, do the things. And when people are in a very close relationship, very close friends also, you know, what one thinks the other will be able to find or will be able to immediately guess. And what one sentence one starts, the other will be able to finish, right? So that is the kind of relationship God planned for man, right? And so when God created man, and when man is supposed to be in a good relationship with God, it would have been very easy for man to know what God had planned for him and to walk in that way, right? So this was the wonderful way in which creation started. But then what happened? We know that sin entered, right? When sin entered, what happened? When sin entered us, it contaminated the likeness of God that was there within man. It contaminated the nature of God which was took place over there. It took the place of the nature of God, right? So now what happens? Everything man could do or act was automatically contrary to what God planned, contrary to what God had planned for them, automatically, because sin is contrary to the nature of God. Okay. So now, did the Lord just leave it? We'll see throughout the Bible that God has been trying to get back man into that intimate relationship with him. We see he shows Noah, and he tried to again start up fresh with Noah. That didn't work out. Again, he chose Abraham. He tried to start afresh and work out with Abraham and his generation. Still, no. So we see he sent prophets, he sent his people, and he sent his son, right? And he said, now I'm going to get back these children, this people which I have created for having a relationship with me, which my creation, which has now become a mess, I want to make it all right. And he made the ultimate sacrifice by coming down to us and then redeeming us. Okay, so now he has redeemed us, and so I believe most of us over here, or all of us over here, would have had the salvation experience. And so we have come into the Lord now. We've started to come back and have a relationship with the Lord, right? So now that once we start to have, once that we start to have this relationship, is it automatic that we are making the right decision, right? Now that is what we say, now we are children of God. Are we making the right decision now that we have compromised with the Lord? We've come back and started to make have a good relationship with the Lord, right? This is what Paul says, right? This is what Paul says in Romans chapter 7:19. I do not do the good I want to do, but the evil I do not want to do, this I keep on doing. Right? Because if you see the epistles of Paul in the Romans, he's writing that, you know, though I've given in my spirit, I have been reconciled with the Lord, and I have, in my spirit, I rejoice in the Lord, and I'm having this lovely relationship with the Lord. This physical body still remains in sin, and so always there is a contradiction between what I'm doing and what I want to do, right? So this is the position in which we are. So to start getting it right with the Lord and to start walking in His plan, we really need His help. And it's not just, the salvation is just the start. We are living for eternity, but in this earth, we are going to live for a very short time. This time, yeah, we are doing such a lot. We are having so many innovations. Everything is happening. But this is the time also for us to choose where we will be in eternity, whether we are going to be with God or whether we are going to lack His presence in eternity, right? So here we find that just by using all our wisdom, our experience, our our knowledge and all these strategies, we are not going to make the right decision just by using all our strengths, right? So we have to depend on something else. Is there something else that's going to help us? Yeah, one thing, we have the Lord. And the Lord, when He created us, He just didn't create us and send us off like that. He has also given us a use your manual, right? When we get gadgets, when we get new gadgets, they come with a user manual. Many times, we just throw the manual aside and try to use it. And because many of the gadgets are user-friendly, we kind of get it. But supposing you might also end up spoiling the whole gadget because you didn't read that user manual, okay? In our lives, we totally ignore this user manual. Many times we think of reading the Bible as just as a, morning I get up, I pray and I read the Bible and go. Because I read the Bible, I will be, protected. Good, you have to read the Bible every day. But the Bible is more than just something, a habit. It's the user manual for how we have to live our lives over here. The Bible gives so many examples of people, right? Examples we have to follow, examples we have to avoid. And so many, many promises are there which strengthens and comforts us. And there are so many instructions over there on how to face life. So here we have the guide, our Bible. And the Bible itself says that thy word is a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my path. So here, now we know that the Bible is definitely going to help us to take better decisions in our lives, decisions that will give us an edge. So does the Bible tell us how to know God's plan is? Does the Bible tell us what God's plan for our life is? Yes, God has a plan for each of us. But does the Bible tell us about it? Okay, there are many verses which help us to know God's plan. I've just put on one, Romans 12:2. Many of you may be familiar with this verse. It's a very important verse, a verse which we should internalize. It says that, do not conform to the pattern of this world, okay? But be transformed by the renewing of your mind. Then you will be able to test and approve God's will, what God's will is. His good, pleasing, and perfect will, right? So it says, first thing, do not conform to the pattern of this world. Do not conform to the pattern of this world. Just think about it. What does it mean? So we are saved. So we go to church. We do read our Bible. We have our quiet time, right? I do that. So God is happy and pleased with me. Then He's given me the job, I go and do the job. In the job also, do you realize, or in your studies, do you realize that God says, do not conform to the pattern of this world? You know, mostly we are all automatically, naturally conforming to the pattern of this world. What the world says is best, we are also running towards it, okay? The values of the world is the same values which we have. Right? But here's the Bible saying, don't conform to the pattern of this world. Okay? So what it means, now we have to just take a moment and see, what are the values of the world? Am I also following those values? Is it pleasing God or not? Do I have to restate my values? Do I have to restate my objectives? Okay? We saw in the very first strategy which I had taken down from the net. First, you have to find your goal. You have to state your goal, right? So here, the first thing we have to do when we want to act according to the Bible and make decision making is we have to restate our goals according to the values of the Word of God. So step one is restate your objective goals in tune with the Word of God. So what do I mean by it? Just see, what is the very first wrong decision in the Bible? The very first wrong decision in the Bible was made by Eve. Yeah, we all blame her, right? So what did she do? Why did she do what she did? Okay, there was the serpent, and the serpent was telling her, see, this fruit, it's very good. It'll make you like God, right? She was told not to eat it, but she said, it'll make you like God. You know, it's wonderful. You'll know good and evil. The serpent was not giving her the whole truth, but he was making it look very attractive, right? So she thought, it's going to make me like God. Wow, that's so attractive. It's desirable. And then she goes ahead and has it and makes the decision to eat the fruit which the Lord had forbidden them to do, right? So what? This is what we always blame Eve, saying, see, because Eve did that, now we are all having to suffer, right? Always people like to tell that, okay? But today, same, just like Eve, we are also making decisions. Today, so many things are put before us and we are made to believe that this is the thing, this is the one, this is the best, this is what you should do. And it is made to look very attractive. And we go ahead and do that. And many times, because of that, we are in trouble. I've seen companies which, for the first few years of their lives, were doing very well. Okay? Then they were, you know, said that you take up this, you take up that. And there are NFBCs, which are ready to give them big loans. And within a few more years, they are deep in debt. Right? There, I've seen good officers, smart officers start up and, you know, work very, very smartly, very intelligently. But few years down the line, you know, they have been, you know, corrupted by the, you know, because of the attraction of power, attraction of money, so many things. And they've been corrupted and they make a mess of their lives, right? So today, and so many things, you know, advertisements, they use serpent strategy only always. Exactly the same strategy of serpent. They don't give us the whole truth and they make it look very attractive, and there we are falling for these things. Okay? Another example from the people, when they were building this Tower of Babel, right? So what did they actually, why did they want to do? Why did they decide to build this Tower of Babel? They said, let us make a name for ourselves. Let us make a name for ourselves. Right? What is wrong with that? That is what everyone wants to do. Today the world is all about that. Make a name for yourself. Make, you know, make a difference. Make money. You know, your children should be here. You were here. Your children should be in a better position. You know, come on, strive harder. Strive harder. Have an ambition. That is what the world is telling. Is that wrong? We find that God wants us to have a different attitude than the rest of the world, right? Many times we think that is the right attitude, right? But we have to just stop and see whether we're having the right attitude. What does some three verses I put? The first verse says, whatever you do, whether in word or deed, do it all in the name of the Lord Jesus. Whatever you do doesn't mean whatever you do in the church or only whatever you do at home. Whatever you do is whatever you do in your professional life, wherever God has placed you, whatever you do, do it in the name of the Lord Jesus, right? No, I've not taught about that before. And in the same chapter, Colossians chapter 3, verse 23 says, whatever you do, work at it with all your heart as working for the Lord and not for human masters, right? Human masters can be your boss, can be yourself. you can be master to yourself. Don't work as if you're working for humans, including don't work as if you're working for yourself, for your own ambition, for I have to come up, I have to do this, I have to get a good name, I have to, you know, be promoted. What is this? This is not what we came here to hear. I think you must be thinking like that. But that is what the Bible says. Whatever you do, do it as if working for the Lord. Let's look at it in the way the Lord looks at it. What are your strengths today? What are you really good at? What are you commended for at your job? What are the skill set which have given you this position? Each one of these things is given to you by God. It is a gift from God. Each of the strength that you have, the education, the knowledge, the aptitude, which has put you where you are, is a gift from God, right? Everything that you have is a gift from God. And the position God has put you in now, okay? Whether you're an entrepreneur or whether you're a professional, whether you're working for the government or whether you're working for the IT industry, wherever you are, it is the position that God has given you. It is the responsibility that God has placed you in. It is the trust God has given you. He has put Aruna over here in this position as a trust. It is given to me as a trust, right? And the next verse, 1 Corinthians 4:2, says that those who have been given a trust must prove faithful. So you are working over there, okay? But you are working with a different goal. You are working not just because you want to get a promotion, not just because you want to make a name for yourselves, but you want to be faithful to this wonderful great God who has given you all these great gifts and also has given you this position, which you have to prove faithful to. And when you're working not for yourself or for your boss, you're working for the great Lord, the Lord of Lords, the King of Kings, I have to really work hard. I have to really prove myself faithful. I have to give my everything into it. Same thing, maybe your colleague in the next desk is doing. He's giving it his everything, but you're giving it your everything. Your objective and goal is different from his. You do your best, right? Because you have to prove faithful to your master, okay? First change in yourself should be that. Why am I working? I have to be faithful to the master who has given me all these skills and who has put me over here. Is this going to work? It's a competitive, cutthroat world. Is it going to really work actually? It's only maybe sounding good inside this room. Outside, will it work? We'll take another example from the Bible. We have Joseph. He was faithful as a son, one of the most trustworthy sons of Jacob. Then he was sold as a slave, bad luck for him. And there, instead of sulking, he again proved faithful and he was put in charge of the whole household of Potiphar, right? He was faced with temptation. Again, he proved faithful and because of that, he was thrown into the prison. But even there, he proved to be faithful. He was put in charge of the whole prison and of prisoners and all the work to be done over there. He continued to be faithful. And God is looking at this Joseph. He's down at the depths. Everyone has forgotten about him. His father thought he was dead. But the Lord is looking at him, looking at him. He's faithful wherever I put him. And he lifts him up right from the prison and out to the palace. Right from the deep depths, he is brought up, right? So that is that extreme example you have. So you are not in the prison or as a slave. God has put you in a good position. Continue to work faithful, not because he's one day going to lift you up, but he will seeing your faithfulness, right? And says that in Genesis chapter 45 verse 8, if you see, it says that Joseph was called as father of Pharaoh. See how much he was lifted to be known as the father of the king of that nation. So we have examples and we need to just have trust in this Lord who we can follow and who has always proved faithful to us. It is our time to be faithful to him. Okay, so first step I said, restate your objectives. Maybe you're doing the right thing, but is your goal right? Because decisions are made based on these goals, these objectives that you make. So if your objective is wrong, it's every reason for your decisions to go wrong. Okay? So what is the verse? You know the verse which I had just shown? Romans 12:2. First thing it said was, do not conform to the pattern of this world. Okay? So change your objectives. Right? So you restate your objectives. What is the next thing it says? Be transformed by the renewing of your mind. So when you change your objective, your values also will have to change. Okay? The values of the world are so different from the values that we as children of God should follow. So what are these values? Like where people are being, you know, manipulative. You know, are being sly, are being, you know, treacherous. There, be pure. You reflect your value through your decisions. So in your, and take decisions which show that you're straightforward. Where people are corrupt, show you are honest. Show your integrity. Where people are being cunning, show that you can be trustworthy. Okay, so these are the values we have to choose. We maybe till now we say that you know, people also would advise and say that, see, this is a cutthroat world. You also have to be, you also have to learn how to do these things. You have to learn how to talk like that. You have to learn how to do like that. And sometimes you might feel that, oh, that's not within me to do that. Right? You're right. It's not within us because we are the children of God. Our value sets are different. Show your values. And how can you show your values? Through your decisions, you can show your values. Don't decide just because somebody else is deciding the same thing. Just think about it and show that, will this decision be pleasing to God? All right? Many times we decide in anger, right? And if we are deciding just in anger, we remember Esau. He was so Cain. Cain was so angry with God, right? Because Cain also sacrificed to the Lord, but the Lord, you know, didn't accept it. So he was really angry. He said, my brother, Abel, God accepted his sacrifice and not mine. So he was really upset about it. He was angry with God, actually. But how did he show this anger? By killing his brother, right? So he killed his brother Abel. So decision taken in anger, right? We have to avoid. So instead of anger, choose forgiveness. We have an example of David. David was being pursued by Saul. David was being pursued by Saul, who was seeking to take his life. And there God gives opportunity to David, not once but twice, where he could have easily killed Saul. But David chooses or decides not to do that. He decides to forgive him, and God honors David for that. So these are the values that we can show. Wherever you put your values, make not only show your personality, it also shows the personality of Christ. Okay, wherever God has placed you, the Bible says that you are a fragrance of Christ, an aroma of Christ, wherever you are being placed. Okay, so people, once you start emanating the values of the Bible, they'll start taking notice of you. Okay? They'll start taking notice of you, even if they're not kind of impressed with you, they will start taking note of you because they're saying, okay, let me see how I can trip this girl up. How can I trip this guy up? Okay? What she is kind of acting very holy. Need not even act holy. You know, certain when you take certain principles and you stick to them, you know, people kind of start watching. Okay, so the watching is good. When they start watching you, that is giving you more opportunity for you to reflect Christ to them. So each of the decisions that you make, you decide whether it is showing material or temporary benefit. Are you deciding for material or temporary benefit, or are you deciding for more eternal benefit? If you are just deciding for temporary benefit, you are not, no better than Esau. Esau, what he did, he sold his birthright just for a bowl of stew, right? if we are just going to take decision based on temporary benefits, we are no better than them. Okay, rather choose the eternal benefit. Okay, we have the example of Mary who sat at the feet of Jesus, okay, choosing eternal benefit. So choose to, it's okay, even if it's very hard, choose to be honest. Choose integrity. Choose these things which would appear very difficult, which you might have to actually, fight, not even, though it may not be a verbal fight, you might have to spiritually fight with everybody around you to stay, you know, honest, to stay with integrity. But do that because you know that you are doing it for your master, and this value is a value which is going to give you benefit up to eternity. Okay? And one more thing, when we're talking about this, deciding on the right value, is don't compromise. Don't compromise, especially in the workplace. It is very easy to compromise. We said it, okay, come on, just have to stand as part of this puja. So what? I'm just going to think about Jesus at that time. Don't compromise. You might be given something to eat, which you know, but you just say, just to please your friend, say, it's okay, God will understand. God will understand, but you, He has been faithful to you. It is time that you are being faithful to Him. So don't compromise. You know why? When you are standing firm, only then you can reflect Christ to others, even in your workplace. And when you are lifted up, when you are lifted up against all odds, against every work of the Satan, every work of your colleagues against you, they will say that, oh yes, she was different. See how this happened to her. How she got this posting. How she got this opportunity. Because that's going to happen. When you are faithful to the Lord, when you change your objectives, when you change your values, it's going to happen. And one day these people who are working in a very worldly way, who are taking up all these tools which the world gives them, will realize that you are different. But if you are not different, then, you know, you've lost the opportunity which God has given you. Okay? So this will give you, as I said, lasting benefit. So what are these values which you should choose on, right? You know, this is Galatians chapter 5 gives us the fruit of the Spirit. But Galatians chapter 5, from verses 19 to 21, also gives us a list of the nature of the acts of sinful nature. And you know that selfish ambition, it's sitting right there among, idolatry, sexual impurity, jealousy, factions, dissensions, fits of anger, all these things are listed, and you'll be surprised to find selfish ambition is one of them. So it is also a sinful nature. So instead of that, choose decisions which will reflect these fruits of the Spirit. Where there is hatred, choose peace. Okay? Where people are being faithless, be faithful. Where Bible says whenever you have it within your control, do good. If it is within your control to do good, don't keep it from the people who deserve it. Okay? Be good. Be kind. Self-control. Okay? Let your decision show your self-control. So these are the things which we can learn from the Bible, how to decide based on the values of the Bible. Okay? So that is step 3, which says that test and approve if it's God's will. How to test and approve if it's God's will? See whether your decision glorifies God. Whether the value which you are showing through this decision is a value which is as per your sinful nature, or is it as per the values of the Bible, or are you showing the fruit of the Spirit? Okay? Does it please God? Is the decision which you're taking pleasing to God? You know, David planned very well, very, he used great strategy, you know, to kill Uriah and to get Bathsheba as his wife. But did it please God? No. Sometimes we can use all the strategy in the world, but for the wrong objective, and if it's not pleasing God. So, step number 3 says, test and approve if it's God's will, right? So, first one was, change your objectives, and then renew your mind, and choose the options which you are, according to the values which are there in the Bible and the values which you should reflect as a child of God. And then the third one says, now test and approve this and say that if I take this option, does it please God? Is it reflecting is it an act of sinful nature that I'll be committing, or is it a reflection of the word of God, right? Okay. Right, now, still one more example I'll show you. Lot made his decision. Lot made a very wise decision. It was very logical, okay? Abraham takes him and shows him the entire place. He looks, he decides very wisely, right? Says that this whole plain of Jordan, okay, it's very fertile, okay? It's very fertile and it's well watered. So this is the place I'll choose. It seems very right. He has used his experience, he's used his wisdom, and he's taken a very logical right decision. But we know that this decision was still proved disappointing to him, because a few years later, he had to leave all his position and just flee for his life. Okay? So what happened? Why? Even when we take such logical and correct decisions, why are we wrong? We are not like kind of doing something malicious or greedy. We just chose correctly. Bible says, trust in the Lord with all your heart and lean not on your own understanding. In all your ways, acknowledge Him and He will direct your paths. Proverbs 3, 5 and 6, very well-known verses, right? But many times we forget to apply it. Trust in the Lord with all your heart. So whenever you make a decision, you put it to the Lord. We have a lot of knowledge, we have experience, we have people, experts who can give us advice, but what they lack, but what the Lord has is, He knows beyond what you know. You know factors 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, which will help you make this decision, but He knows factors 7, 8, 9, 6, 7, all those factors, which might prove your decision to be wrong. The Lord knew that plain also had the cities of Sodom and Gomorrah. He knew that these people were going to were sinful and going to be destroyed. Okay, if Lot had spent some time and said, Lord, show me, the Lord might have shown him. Many times we make these hasty decisions because we think that it can never go wrong. It's right, we can never fail with this. I have all the ingredients to make this a success, but yet it would fail because we have failed to take it to the Lord. So trust in the Lord with all your heart and lean not on your own understanding. So step 4, entrust the decision to God. Entrust the decision to God. Believe that God discerns beyond your understanding. Okay? We have our understanding, we have our assumptions, but God discerns much more than that. So take it to the Lord. Sometimes you might have kind of made a decision, okay? And then you take it to the Lord, and then you keep praying, like, Lord, please, that decision, if it is like this, I'm praying, Lord, but if you decide like this, it'll be good. So we are not fully giving the reins to the Lord. We are holding on to the reins and saying, Lord, help me make the right decision. Hand over the reins to the Lord. Completely hand over the reins to the Lord. And another thing is, beware of making deals with the Lord, right? Lord, if this happens, or if you show me this, I'm going to do this. If you give me victory, don't make deals with the Lord when you're asking Him to decide. He will decide and He will give you the victory, but you don't make deals. We know the example of, Jephthah. He made a deal with the Lord. I don't know really whether he thought about it. He said that whatever comes out of my tent to greet me, I will offer it as a sacrifice. I don't know what he expected, whether a goat or a cow would come out of his tent. He's coming back victorious. Maybe he didn't trust that he would be victorious. Okay, he's coming back home victorious and his daughter comes to greet him. Oh, what a disappointment for him. What a great tragedy that he had to sacrifice his daughter. Right? So beware of making any deals with God. We actually make a lot of deals. God is so gracious, He doesn't take it out on us. Right? So leave the decision, entrust it to the Lord, and and just be quiet in His presence so that you will be able to hear His direction. Okay? The Lord directs in different ways. Okay? Sometimes through this word of God, sometimes through someone else, He might be showing you the direction. Sometimes He gives you the peace to know the right decision. Sometimes he just opens up new doors, okay, to know that this is the decision. Suddenly something new will come into your vision, which you'll know that the Lord has shown you. Okay, so unless you entrust the decision to the Lord and wait patiently for Him, okay, then you will know the right decision, which will be in correlation with the plan God has for you. The other example I was thinking of is of Moses. Now, God had a plan for Moses that Moses will rescue His people. Moses will rescue His people from the Egyptians, okay, from Pharaoh. It was within Moses' plan. But why Moses, when he was 40 years old, you know Moses of 40 years old, how he was? If you read in Acts chapter 7, it says that Moses was trained in all the wisdom of the Egyptians. Well trained. Well trained with all physical training for wisdom. Everything he was given. And it says, you'll be surprised to know, it says that Moses was powerful in speech and in deed. In speech and in action, he was powerful. At the age of 40, he was powerful in speech and in action. And he was well trained in all the wisdom of Egypt. And now he thinks it, yes, I'm ready. Now I have to go and rescue these people, and he starts. What happens? He meets with failure and he has to flee from that place. Okay? Now, it was within God's plan. What was the problem? Okay? The other says, in all your ways acknowledge Him and He will direct your paths. Wait for the Lord's direction. The plan is there, and the Lord not only plans, He also knows the way and the time to bring this plan into action. Okay? So when Moses thought that he had all the strengths and he had all the qualities to now save his people, it was not the Lord's time. And he flees, and Moses probably lost hope and said, okay, I think it's not within my life's plan to do that. And he just becomes his humble self. 40 more years pass, 80 years, and at 80, the Lord says, Moses, now go and rescue my people. And at that time, he says that, Lord, how can I go? Who am I? He says, who am I? When he was 40, he said, I am the right person. And he goes. But at 80, when he says, who am I? I am nothing, Lord. I have nothing. When he just came to that point, when he said he has nothing, and he gave the reins over, and he gave the full glory to God. And he says, I cannot speak also. Ah, surprising. At one part of the Bible, it says that he was powerful in speech. But by 80, he says that I am not eloquent. He says that I am nothing, Lord. I am not eloquent. The Lord that time chooses and sends him, and he saves his people from the Pharaoh. So wait for the Lord's time. The Lord has a plan for you. The Lord also has planned the time for you. Maybe you are now planning and deciding that you want to jump away and do this. You are just reaching out for something. But maybe it's not the Lord's time. Wait on the Lord, and at His right time, He will show you, right? So, submit all your abilities, strengths, and weaknesses to the Lord. Pray for His guidance and wait for His direction, right? So, and He will lead you. So, this is step number 5. 40 years later, as I said, God sends Moses to rescue His people. So God not only has a plan, but He knows the time and place to fulfill it. And one more beware over here. Beware of taking your own decisions to fulfill God's plan. Now that reminds us of Sarah. Okay? God has taken Abraham out and showed him that, see, all the stars in the sky, if you can count it, count it. Okay? That many are going to be the offspring from you. So, I'm sure Abraham shares all this with Sarah. And Sarah is wondering, my God, I've become old. Now things so okay. God wants this to happen. So, I think now I have to help God out in His plan. So, she brings her maid and gives her to Abraham. And we know that even today, that mistake is still having its repercussions. Okay? So, don't go ahead and think that you have to do something to help God to fulfill His plans. God will fulfill His plans in His time, right? So, just to recap, we know that God has the very best plan for you, right? And our life would be the most victorious if we decide according to God's plan, So how can we do this? The Bible is our guide to knowing all and deciding according to God's plan. And so once we go through the steps that we went through, what was the first step? It says that restate your objectives and goals in tune with the Word of God. Right? And then step two says, renew your mind to select options which show your values as a child of God. What was the third step? Third step said, now you test and approve and see which is the right option that I should take. And you can ask yourself the questions, is it pleasing to God? Is it glorifying God? Is it showing the fruits of the Spirit? Okay? And then you step four, entrust the decision to the Lord. Believe that God discerns beyond your understanding because He knows beyond. He knows what is there in your future and He can guide you, right? And then step five, okay, submit to all your abilities, everything that you think is your strength and even your weakness. Submit to the Lord. Sometimes we think that I can't do this, I'm weak. Just like Moses said, everything you submit to the Lord and you wait for His direction and He will direct you. So with these things, I think if we internalize these things, slowly the Lord will show us His plan and we all can live a victorious life. So thank you. I just want to finish with this one chorus which I learned, which you all might be knowing, but this chorus always I kept singing throughout my life, which helped me to believe that nothing is going to happen which is against the Lord's will. I know who holds the future, and I know He holds my hand. With God, things don't just happen. Everything by Him is planned. So as I face tomorrow, with its problems great and small, I trust the Lord of miracles, give to Him my all. I think that chorus, if you remember, will sum up all these things that we're seeing, and then we can trust the Lord on our decisions. Thank you very much once again for the opportunity.